Hi, I'm Peter Pedro Bonzaki Noe Watts, according to Pop Cummins, and this is my life story. Well, I was born on the 14th of December 1937 in the Inglewood Hospital to Florence Emma Butcher and Frederick Harold Watts. I was, as it turned out, I was the last of their family, another brother to Frederick, Fred and Jack and Jim, Arthur and my sister Dorothy, who was a bit disappointed. She thought she might have got a girl, a sister. And I was named later on as Peter William. Even though 1937, it was the modern times, there was cars and planes, and I think there was even television somewhere, and there was radio and telephone. But in the countries of Australia, Victoria, and worse up in Queensland and so forth, we're still living in the old times. There were still horses and carts going up and down the road, and we had no electricity, no running water much. It was like that well up into the 1940s. And then, top it off, 39, the Second World War started. I was about 1.5. And I was too young to know my brothers. I only knew of my sister Dorothy and my brother Arthur. The others went into the army, although they weren't living at home anyway. They were living away, and they sort of just weren't in my life at all. But my first memories of the war was when my brother Jim got wounded in action. And, of course, it was a big drama at home, and it must have sort of stuck with me. I can remember the stuff going on about that. But that's what I sort of grew up to, is war. And the subject was going on every day, of course, with three brothers in the army. And eventually I got old enough when I was about four or five, they started to come home on leave. Like, this was Jack and Fred, and which was... I thought it was pretty good when they used to unpack their bag and have some presents for me and so forth. I used to look forward to seeing them, but I never seen Noe till way probably I was 8 or 9 years old before he actually came back to Inglewood. And another thing with my early memories was the things I had when I was around the 4 or 5 year old mark was... We had a little rocking horse, and I had a trike. It was pretty wobbly. I know it used to tip me off. I can remember trying to ride that thing. And then later on, Dad got me a little pedal car, little Cyclops. And I just loved that thing. I was never out of it. I don't know how much worry I gave my mother, because I was always up the bush. I was anywhere but home with it. And eventually, after a trip to Melbourne with my mother to see her sister, I found out there was a railway station, because I went with her, and it was walk over the railway line, and there was and the steam trains going up and down, and I was fascinated with all that sort of stuff. So when we actually arrived back from Melbourne and settled back home, and I could hear steam trains going up there at the railway station about a mile or more away, I got in my little pedal car and went up there. Down the street, across the main road, and up past the railway station, up there, up over the top there at the walkway, and watching the trains go underneath. And I'm only about 4 or 5. I'm supposed to be home. I'm disappeared for a couple of hours up there. And this went on a few times. And I don't know, Mum must have wondered, they must have wondered where the hell I got to and what was happening. And at last, Dad must have found out off the local carrier, Mick Treble, that he's seen me up at the station. So Dad must have said, well, next time you see him up there, hunt him home. So this day I go there on my car, and I'm little pedal car, and I'm climbing up the ramp to watch the trains again, and this bloke yelled out, what are you doing here? And virtually hunted me home. That was it. That was the end of that story, but that was that was a drama. And that's only the first one. And when I was About six, I think, is when the war finished. And I started school when I was six. I went to the St. Mary's School in Inglewood. And I used to walk to school, which was a fair way. It'd be, you know, a mile and a half, and say a couple of kilometres or something. So Dad, and I, from one of my uncles, had gave me a scooter with rubber pump-up tyres, which was pretty flash in them days. But Dad wasn't very happy with the fact that I was wearing out one shoe, because he used to mend, keep me shoes mended, and he was running out of leather. So he put a... He altered the bike, this scooter, put a carrier on it, and made up a bracket with a driving wheel, and turned it into a push bike, in other words, for me to ride to school on. Well, it was about every 100 yards was about 1,000 turns of the crank on this thing. It was very low geared, but anyway, that's what I did for a while. And then one day I come home from school, and Mum wanted me to go and get some sausages for tea. So I hopped on the bike and down to the butcher shop I goes to get the sausages. Bonser and Dad were both working at the mill at the time, and they were due home that night for tea. Instead of coming home with the sausages, I went down to the mill. And I rode this thing down 4 miles, which is about 6 k's, to Bridgewater to the mill, for some reason or other. Caused a big stir down there. They said, "Who's this bloke, this kid coming in on this thing into the mill?" And anyway, so Dad wasn't very happy, and Bonza had to take me home. He left a bit earlier, and he dunked me home with a bike over his shoulder, with a scooter over his shoulder, because it was headwind, and I would have been there for about 2 hours riding it home. it was so low geared. And I got in a hell of a lot of trouble over that. Just a bit about the house. We lived in a four-bedroom, well, it was two bedrooms and a lounge and a dining room and a kitchen in the old house. And it was all paper and hessian when I was a kid. They got moved around a little bit because my brother, Bonza, he lived in a sleep out the back, mainly because sort of wasn't much difference between him and Doss and ages, and they so he sort of went out there, out of the road. So left Doss to have a room of her own, though I did share it with her because I was only a baby. And so I shared a bit of time with Doss in the bedrooms. And we changed from the dining room to the lounge a couple of times. That got altered about a little bit. Originally the lounge had a piano and there was a music room, and then later on it turned into a bedroom, and the dining room was turned into the lounge and that sort of thing. But other than that, most of the activities happened in the kitchen. When all my uncles and everybody had arrived for some birthday or just weekends, they're all in the kitchen, all talking at once. Been down the pub and had a few guts full of beer and made them worse, and they all just went on in that kitchen. You could hardly hear yourself talk or anything. It was just so loud. They were laughing and carrying on, and Mum's trying to cook dinner, and yet we'd have it all there. I don't know how we all fed it in there, but Mum would feed everybody a roast dinner, and it was the activities happened in there. Bonza would come, other things that happened there, he'd have a motorbike, my engine pulled to pieces. At night, he'd put it together on the kitchen table with this bloody old light that you'll see. No power, nothing. And I even had a fight in there. Some bloke come there one time with a kid there, and they were so good at fighting that he sealed them onto me. But Peter come with his left hand, according to Mum, and knocked him ass over head. And that stopped that. But everything happened in that kitchen. It was, and I don't know, when you see the size of it, I don't know how it all happened in there. As well as the family that I lived in the house, next door in a block was a miners' right block that actually finished up. We owned eventually, got it changed over. There was a miners' cabin in there, and my grandmother, Kate Fallahay, his brother Michael, who was a cripple, was lived in this miners' hut. And Mum sort of looked after him, because Kate died when I was probably only about a couple of years old. And he lived on for quite a while. So he was the next one in the family. But he lived in this little, just a bed, and there was a fireplace and a few photos. And that was Mick, Uncle Mike. Dad was a very inventive person and creative. He loved to push his body with sports and work. He was interested in carnivals. He always wanted his own merry-go-round of all things. Loved horses. He didn't go much for motor cars, and I'm thinking perhaps it's because he just wanted to... It was too easy. He just wanted to ride bikes, and he raced push bikes and all that sort of thing. Played football. He was very keen on football. I think a motor car was too easy for him. So it had to be hard work, whatever he had to do. And that sort of comes out in a few. And he worked on a farm, drove horses, carted wheat into Crongvale, where they used to have to stack, this was 90 kilograms of wheat bags they had to handle and load up in a lorry and take it into Crongvale and load it into a stack. In the summertime, it was pretty hot over there, so they used to send one of the guys over to the pub to get a bucket of beer. And they'd just share the bucket while they were working, drink it, and send him back for another one. But that's the sort of thing they used to do, these fellas. After work, we worked at the mill later on in life, and they used to cut leaves to make a bit of extra money. That was all very hard yakka. And he cut wood. He cut his own wood. He used to sit at home there at night time, sharpen them up at night. He could shave with his axe and his Euclid hooks. And he could cut a mallee down about a 90 to 100 millimetre mallee down in two hits with this. I've seen him do it many a time. One hit one side, one the other side, and down we go the tree. So, anyway, that was... And he went in wood chops till up in his 60s. He still went and competed in wood chops out at Riola. And the other thing, Dad, was musical. I forgot to add that. He could play the mouth organ and button accordion. So that was the other part that sort of rubbed off on the family. So I think he had a fair influence on us all. And he worked at the flour mill. He was on shift work down there for many years. Apparently he was strong, though they classed him as a pretty strong sort of a man, and they loaded him up one day with a bag of wheat under each arm, and two across his shoulders. And he had to go about 10 metres to the loading ramp with those. And you were talking about 80-odd kilos each bag. when Dad was... got onto working a normal shift of 9 till 5, five days a week, well, Friday night was the big pot night with his mates. And he might be a bit late home for tea, and Mum would be waiting for him to give it to him. So a lot of times he'd sneak in the back. I used to see him, he'd sneak in the back and start splitting a bit of wood up, making out he's been home for a while. So I've actually tried that trick myself a couple of times. It works okay, because they come out and I'm not too sure how to growl at you, because I don't know how long you've been home for, but it's... So anyway, Mum used to nag him a bit because of this business going on, this drinking of a Friday night, coming home drunk. And eventually you get to the stage where you start banging the table He would never lay a hand on Mum or anything like that, but he used to bang the table and things would fall off sometimes and smash on the floor. So that was his way of taking a bit of aggression out. And at this point, I think we'll talk about the in the mid-40s when we were kids running around the bush. We must remember there was a lot of mines around. We used to do some terrible things. We hang on to one kid's feet while he's getting eggs out of a nest, dangling down a 30, 40-foot mine. These sort of things used to happen. The parents must have would have been mad if they had known what we used to actually get up to. But that was it, and we had dams we used to swim in up the Unity Dam, not far from here now. We spent nearly every day in the summer swimming there, but the other parts of the years we'd be out to be bird nesting, and we all had gings where we'd that were like a shanghai made rubber made out of a fork of a tree and a car tube and a bit of leather off a bell out of a shoes, and we made these things up they call gings. And we'd be shooting at things we shouldn't have shot at. Used to go to old tips where there was real flash jugs and plates and what all that sort of stuff, and smash them to pieces with these gings. And we used to have clay fights and even used to shoot at each other with these gings till somebody get hit and go home bawling, and that'd be the end of that. But that was what we used to get up to. Good stones to fire out of the ging were down in the railway line. They were wash stones that they put down between Inglewood and Bolly Creek. They were just like marbles, really. And we used to gather those stones so that they used to fire nice and straight and have them out of our gings. And we used to go down the river and do later on and do a bit of fishing with a bamboo stick as a rod. That's all we could afford. And catch a redfin or two. So it was that part of it was fairly normal, but it was we used to do some hair raising things around these mines. So back in the summers of in my school days, you know, when I was around the 10, 8, 10, well, through that sort of time, we lived up at the Unity Dam in the summertime. It was just. It seemed to be 100 degrees every day. So that was it. We'd have breakfast, go up to the dam, come home for dinner, then go up to the dam again till 4 or 5 o'clock. That was it every day. We just lived there, and we'd just run around the bush with mud on us, making out we're Aborigines sometimes, and just generally just spend the day up at the dam. There was mullock heaps up there where we used to have fights, clay fights, and ride bikes around the cyanide pits, and it was all happened up at the Unity Dam. Everything was there. And I think I was telling me mate Bertle the other day, all that time up there swimming every day, I learnt to swim there, I'd only be living on Wheaties. I'd have a plate of Wheaties before I went. I'd come home and have a plate of Wheaties at dinner time, and then that was it. The only proper meal I'd have would be tea time. We'd have a proper meal, but I lived on Wheaties because I only had time to gobble that down. It'd only take me 1 minute to have the Wheaties, where it'd take a long time to feed. I had no time to muck around with tough food at all. That was a good time. Well, my first job, I left school when I was 14. My birthday's at the end of the year anyway, that was the following year. I started work at the Nixon's grocery store as a spud boy, weighing spuds and out the back room there, preparing things for the orders and that sort of stuff. They had a bike with a sidecar on it. And I sometimes have to take an order out on that, which was a bit of a pull, because we might have a 4 gallon tin of kerosene and a bag of bran and an order, fairly weighty stuff. And the whole thing would have weighed, had a big box on it, would have weighed probably 30 or 40 pound on its own. And so the bike and everything was fairly heavy. It was hard pushing. And I used to have to deliver orders with that occasionally. Later on, I got sort of moved up a little bit, and I used to go out on a new bike that I brought and get the orders on that, which was a lot better. I brought a new Hartley from the local distributor here in Inglewood, and Dern Pucky was his name. It was a semi-racer, cost me about £20. I think I paid it off at £10 a week, £10 a week, because I only got £3 a week wages. And so it would have taken me about 2 years to pay for it. And I had three-speed hub gears put into the back wheel, and so it was a bit of extra. It was special bike. Bill had to build the wheels for me. But it was a great bike. And from then on, that was bikes. And we used to have tracks out around the bush where we'd ride, we actually, the mountain bike business that goes on now, we were doing that back then. We used to go all the way out to the caves just to race down and do that sort of stuff, and some of the other hills around the place here, and we had big mullock heaps we used to race down, and we used to go even at night time out in the bush with our generators and do these night time mountain bike races, you may as well say, at night in the dark till somebody everybody used to crash. But anyway, so that went on for quite a while, and then I built myself then a special bike to do this on, and I put suspension on it, had telescopic forks. This was way before anybody ever thought of doing this. Swing arm suspension and a sort of a dual seat sort of a thing on it. We haven't got a photo of it. There's bits of it that are still about. It was a forerunner of the modern mountain bike, and this was back in about 1952 or 3 when this was happening. And another thing we used to do, which was frowned upon a bit by the law, was we'd go to Bridgewater at night when we were about 16 and that. We'd be down the street at night there, and we'd catch a truck as it went round the corner at the main street at a slow speed. We'd all get in behind the truck and go to Bridgewater, hanging on to the truck or just pedalling behind it at about 40, 50 mile an hour. And then we'd wait for another one to come over the bridge at Bridgewater and come back the same way. And there might be four or five of us behind these trucks. We got the idea from a local bloke that he had a really good racing bike with hub gears and chain gears. So it'd give him a big range of gears on his bike. And he used to do the same. This is where we got the idea from. On a Sunday, he'd be waiting for the bus, to Provincial Motors bus, to go to Bendigo. And as soon as it'd slow down to go around the corner at Appleby's Corner down there, he'd be behind it and he'd go to Bendigo, followed the bus all the way down in the slipstream. And he'd do the same coming home of a Friday night. The bus driver knew he was there. It was just the thing he used to do. So if he could do it, we thought we'd do it. And that's what we were only doing it with trucks, not with a bus. I worked at Nixon's for a couple of years. As I wasn't getting much money there, I eventually got on to working at the exchange. It was a week about with another boy, and we were on night shift. So that meant that we had a bed in the exchange, a big bell, and so if anybody rang through the night, we'd answer the call and put them through. This is with the old switchboard with little shutters that come down and told you what number was ringing and where to plug, and then you'd plug into to wherever they wanted to go. Sometimes you had to go through Bendigo to get to Melbourne. Well, the bell was too loud, and we used to put the paper behind it so so we couldn't hear it. And so one night there, this fella rang up, and of course I didn't answer the phone. I was asleep and couldn't hear it, and I had to come round to the exchange to see what was going on, and that I got in a bit of trouble over that one. I decided to try for another job, and I got a work with the local electrician. At that stage, the power was going through to Serpentine area, and he had a lot of work to do there to rewire some of the old houses up. We're running on home lighting plants and stuff. So I worked there on that job for about 12 months, and I learnt quite a lot and was doing a fair bit of work myself. I could wire a house at that stage, but I was having trouble with climbing up poles. I didn't like heights, and I nearly fell off the top of a pole there one day, and I thought, well, that's it. I forgot to put the strap around the post and leant back, and I was just caught the wires on the way down. So I gave that away. And that was the time when we decided that it was time to get a motorbike. And we Boodle and my mate, we brought this old clapped out BSA Bantam off a fella at this stage. And we used to ride it around the bush. Though it was that clapped out, it wouldn't pull both of us. It'd pull me on my own, but as soon as Boodle would get on the back, it'd stop. And the worst of it was I'd kick him in the head as I was getting on, and make matters worse, he'd be very shitty about that. But yeah, we used to have a lot of fun on that thing. From then on, we sort of progressed and got two Jawas. I brought one and off a local fella here, a 250 Jawa, and Boodle brought one, and we used to ride him around the bush, and that was that's when that's all started. I'd only had my licence a few months. At that time, the new law came in that you had to have your motorcycle licence 12 months before you could carry a pillion passenger. But it was only new in, and nobody thought, I didn't think much about that. And I wanted to take my friend Billy Wallace up to the motorcycle races at Mildura. And he wanted to go, and so we went. We loaded this jar up with a couple of suitcases, which is a photo there somewhere of, and up to Mildura we went. Well, in them days it was dirt road from Oyen to Mildura. It would have been about 1950 or something. No, it'd be a bit later, about 54, 5, I suppose, when this happened. And so we went up to Mildura. We got there in a day. I don't know how we could only do about 45, 50 mile an hour with the two of us on it. We finished up with about three broken spokes by the time we got there from the corrugations up the other side of Oyen. And I fixed that up. Then we used to go to Eye Rimple in Redcliffs to the pool every day because it was stinking hot. And there used to be buses of young girls and that going to the pools. And so this day, we used to follow these buses and and Billy used to be giving the cheek to the sheilas in the bar. They were hanging out the windows and carrying on. So this day, I stopped and he had him back to front, on the back, and we chased the bus and caught up with it. And so he's really they're all having a lot of fun. Oh, we're getting along this beside the bus. He's on back the front, waving to all the sheilas in the bus and carrying on. And a cop come the other way. I didn't say anything to Bill. I just put my head down and off. I went around the first corner to the left and I looked around and I see he's turning around. He's going to chase us. So I went down some street down and then I went to the right, and as I went around to the right, I looked back and he's coming around the next corner, the previous corner, sideways. So I went around from block to block to block, and every time I looked back, he would be just one block back, just coming around the corner after me. Bill's on the back, facing the other way, wondering what the hell's going on, and I'm scratching foot press on the ground. I'm really laying her over. And at last I run into a dead-end block, Couldn't go any further. I had to turn around to come out, because as I come around to turn around to go out, he's coming in, blocked me off. So I thought, hello, I'm in jail here. But anyway, it didn't happen. He just gave us a hell of a lecture, asked me for my licence, which I had on me with first licence written on in big letters, and I put that in, left that in my pocket and said, no, I haven't got it on me at the moment. And he just gave us a lecture, and we went agreed with him it was a silly thing to do and all the rest of it, and he let us off. But it was a bit of a drama and a bit of a worry there for a while. And that was my little episode with the Jawa and Mildura. And then I got working on a baker's cart and delivering bread. And I didn't mind that, it was okay. And that went on for about 12 months, I suppose. Hopped on me Jawa there one night, it was about 1957, and went down to see Bill Harley down at Festival Hall. I'd never been to Melbourne on a motorbike, and I went down on a Jawa, parked out the front, I don't know how I found my way there, and went to that concert. So that was the start of a lot of stuff, which we'll get into later. After the we worked on the baker's cart, I think we went, I got on the railways then, I went, yes I did, I went working on a special gang up at Bort, on a welding gang up there, and I traded the Jawa in on an aerial motorcycle then, a 650, and it wasn't long, I was only working there for a few weeks, and my bike got stolen, so there was another episode there. It was found up in Renmark about a couple of weeks later, and there's a bit of a story attached to that one. And I went up, hitchhiked up to Renmark and picked it up and brought it home and rode it home. Petrol tank was leaking, a few little things wrong with it, but anyway. Yeah, well, after the special gang job finished, I went fruit picking. Shepparton, me and Verdon went up there and we done a bit of that, and then after that, it was only casual work. Noel Dealey and myself went up, I turned 21 actually, in Melbourne. We had a party at my sister's place, at Dorothy's place down there when I turned 21, and on that morning, on the Sunday morning, we went to 3DB, and Noel used to sing not a bad sort of a song, and I backed him up on the guitar, and we played on air that morning when I was 21. But after that, a few months later, we left and went up to Queensland to the shearing sheds. Noel was a shearer, and he talked me into going up there, and so that was I always wanted to go to Queensland, and that was the opportunity, and so we went up there and put in a season up there around Longreach and Winton, all on the outback there. And I went down to a place called Billa Wheeler. I think I had about £5 left on me and badly needed a job. And I got a train to a part of the way to a place called Wowan, and then I hitchhiked to Billa Wheeler. Went to the police station and asked them if there was any work about. The policeman knew a fella there and introduced me to him, and I got working at a peanut farm, and it was a good job. I really enjoyed working there. We stooking peanuts, so I worked on a harvester and various other jobs around there. Noel got another contract out at Winton, and we went out there, and that was the end of that. That's all we done then until it was time to come home that Christmas. We came back again, and I went back on the railways. Worked there for about 12 months, and we went back up with Noel, went back to Queensland again. I'd done a bit of fencing with Noel while this was going on in between. And we went back and did another stint, this time at Longreach with our headquarters, and we worked around that area. And when that job finished up, I did a fill-in job at a cotton ginry at Rockhampton, waiting to come home. And Christmas time we came back, and that was the end of that episode. I eventually went back on the railways again in 1961, and that carried me right through till I went on the Lands Department in about 1969 or 70, 60, about 68, I think. I went on the Lands Department. I was married by then, and we wanted to settle down, and that was at Bort, where I've got that job. I knew people up there, and plus the fact that Frank Rees and my sister Dorothy lived there, and so we made it our home there at Bort for many years later on. The Lands Department job lasted for about 2 or 3 years, and they cut back on the workforce, and I was last on. I went off the John Varco, the me boss, went and chased a job up for me on the Water Commission, and so I went from one job to the other, and there I stayed till way up in the 80s, till I give that job away, and we went back up to Queensland to run a shop, and I was to work out in the gem fields. That was back in about 88 or something. The idea was for Sheila and Tracy or Karen to look after the shop. That was their business, and I was to go out on the gem fields with Noel on the sapphires. Well, because we had a bit of trouble with Tracy, she didn't like being up at Rockhampton, she missed going to school down here at Bort, so she came back home and actually stayed with my sister Dorothy. So that left Karen and Sheila up in the shop. And then Karen came back. Sheila on her own. So things didn't work out properly as we planned for a while, but eventually we got somebody else to help her out with the shop, Noel's sister actually. And I went out in the gem fields, and we set up a mine up out there with machinery, and so we started getting a few sapphires and making a few dollars out there. It was all cash. I had a little house out there. Noel owned it, and I just had rent free. And all was good out there for a while till Sheila got sick. And eventually we had to come home. She just couldn't handle the shop. So anyway, we made a few dollars, and it was a great experience to be out there in the gem fields. While I was there, I joined the Lions Club and done my little bit for the community. It was quite good. We had a license, so any functions it was on, we done all the catering for that. And yeah, it was quite a good, an interesting time in my life out there. So we came back to Bort. We still had the house at Bort. My son Barry was looking after it and living there with a few of his mates there, camped there, having a good time. So we upset that when we came back. They had to kick them all out. There's a couple of girls there as well. I sort of got interested in the sound of a steel guitar. I used to listen to, later on when we did eventually get power on, get a radio going, which in about 48, started listening to music, and I liked the sound of a steel guitar. I could, the American, Hank Williams and those sort of fellas, and Hawaiian music use a steel guitar. So I was very interested in that, and eventually I brought a guitar, an old Pacific guitar, and I've got to put the bridge on it to build it, make it into a steel, and I've got a manual for how to play in 5 minutes sort of thing. And that's what I mucked around with for a couple of years, trying to play this thing. And then one day on the radio I heard this song called Guitar Boogie. Well, I thought it was played on a steel guitar, which was wrong. It was played on a Spanish guitar. But I used to try and play it. And there was another song called 12th Street Rag. And I brought the records, 78s, all done with the same fella, Guitar Boogie Smith. But it was almost impossible to try and play those songs. And I didn't realise I had the wrong guitar. Then one day I went to a concert and there was a local fella playing a bit of Slim Dusty on an ordinary guitar, and I thought, oh, I reckon I could do that. So I took the bridge out from underneath my guitar and I got home and I remembered where he put his fingers and I copied it and I played the song and I found I could do that. So now I've realised that that we can do other stuff. When rock and roll was the thing that really kicked me on music, I just couldn't believe how good it was. I just loved it. And we were going to Bendigo one day in a car with some of my mates, and we were just going over the bridge there at Bridgewater, and this song called Jailhouse Rock come on the radio, and it just done something to me. That was it. From then on, I was definitely a rock and roll man. Back in the late 50s, amplifiers and electric guitars were hard to come by. They were an American thing that was hard. I don't know whether you could buy any in it. I never ever seen any in Bendigo anyway. So if you wanted an amplifier, you had to make it yourself. Well, I had was a bit lucky. I had help with people that knew a bit about it and sort of shown me how to convert a radio out of into an amplifier and build pickups and preamplifiers and things like that. So I made my own. I made quite a few amplifiers. And, it was a good interest, but anyway, that's what happened. But we actually went in a battle of the bands at one stage, and with our own homemade amplifiers, we arrived at the venues, and by this stage you could buy Fender amplifiers. This is getting on a bit. I think the Twilights is on the scene at this stage. And we walked in there to play, and there was all these Fender amplifiers. Well, we'd never seen so many knobs. Didn't know how to work the things. We're only used to three knobs. And I said to the fella at the, I took one look at the stuff and said, we can't operate this. We're going to be there for half a day just trying to sort out a sound. I said, that band that was supposed to be playing there from Inglewood, they're going home. somebody got crooked, they had to go home. I said, we're there all the time. I wasn't going to play. So I just told them we went home. In the meantime, because the steel guitar didn't have much volume, I seen in the Weekly Times that you could buy a pickup and turn into an electric. Well, it was, as far as I know, that was the only electric guitar you could buy was a steel guitar, not an ordinary guitar. Anyway, I sent away and got this pickup, and it turned out that when I put it on, you couldn't hear it. It wasn't any good. And Don Walker, who is Ashley's father, who's married to me, Arthur's Bonds's daughter, Leonie, he said, oh, yeah, I know what's wrong. You need a booster, a preamp, in other words. So he made one up with a battery in it and a little valve in it, and from now on I had electric guitar. Well, I didn't realise it, but I was probably the only one in Bendigo and north of Bendigo. Nobody had any of these sort of things. And the amplifier was only made out of an old radio with a pickup terminals on it. And that was it. And we did actually put in a little box with its own 12-inch speaker, and so I had electric guitar, they were very rare. Anyway, when rock and roll started, I was already had electric guitar. Well, the only thing was, mine was didn't look much. It didn't look like anything like these solid body things that you've seen in Rock Around the Clock and on the. And Bill Harley and them fellas used. I don't think you could buy them in Australia even. Anyway, so I made one. I got this old Pacific guitar that I was using for the steel and pulled it to bits. And I come up with this thing here. You can see it's just thin, a solid body guitar. Made my own electric guitar back in 1957. And then tried to get rock and roll bands going, which was another thing, but we didn't have any idea of what was really needed, and we only had used cornets and trombones and stuff like that, no saxophones, nobody had anything like that around the place. So we were trying to play rock and roll at the dances with the wrong instruments, didn't go that well. And then later on, I taught two other fellas to play, and we actually brought a bass. By that stage, you could actually start to buy electric things. The Japanese got onto the market, and you could actually buy electric guitar or electric bass. So we brought Briony Wallace brought electric bass, and Ian Leach made his own guitar, well, I helped him, and like mine there. And that's how we started off, and we used to do instrumentals, and we went in a few concerts, and then Briony went away, and Ernie Johns took on the bass, and so we had a couple of years of mucking around with that sort of stuff, doing instrumentals and that, till I went away until I got married and was on the railways, and it wasn't until I settled down at Bort that actually my musical career started. I got in with a proper band and we made money. How I came to get playing with Leo and those fellas, because we were getting into the music seriously sort of thing, was I met a fella on the railways, before I was married, actually, that played in a jazz band and in a brass band. And we had a few couple of jams at his place, and I used to take the bass there and have a bit of a play with him. And he invited me to go to Hart's Hotel at Witcherproof, they were into the jazzy sort of scene there, and they used to have a do of a Saturday night. And so I went. Well, I had a ball there. So that started it off, and I used to go there every Saturday night, and we used to play, and then we had, they were just great nights, and I played with these guys. We had drums, piano, trombone, trumpet, and that was really good. And they started to put on a musician's day off a Sunday, once a year. And Leo and was there with another band playing, and I was playing, and that we met there. And then later on, there was a vacancy coming in his band when the lead guitarist had an accident, got killed, worse luck. And I actually filled in. That's how it all started. That was about 1970. And we played for 3 years in a band called the Cassettes, and we played in the clubs and played, we done everything, kitchen teas, young farmers balls, weddings, cabarets, everything. When I first started playing music with Leo Tellison and Jimmy Callahan, there was a 10-year gap between me and Leo, and Jimmy was even younger again, so I felt a little bit, didn't sort of fit in too well. I was receding hair, and they had, it was in the 70s when the flare era was on with and long hair. So I brought a wig. And that I sort of fitted in. I felt comfortable and they were happy. But nobody in the town knew who I was when I was playing. I used to play, we used to do stuff in Bort. My workmates and that would be there. They didn't know who I was or anything. Over in Donald, where Leo came from, they all knew me as Hat because of this wig. They called me Hat. And they knew who I was. But nobody in Bort knew who this bloke was that played in the band. And so that was a nickname that stuck for a long time, Hat, because of this wig. And sometimes when we were coming home in the car at night, I'd take the wig off naturally. And I'd just sit it on my hand and I'd put it between me and Leo and he'd be another person coming home, you know. We used to talk to him. That sort of carried on for a while, and while I was on the nicknames, I know it's just sort of getting off the music, but I might as well keep on it just for a sec. Up at Bort, for some reason or other, I used to tinkle around with electronics a fair bit, and somewhere one of the blokes at work got onto the fact that I used to mention watts quite often. So he nicknamed me 40 Watts and Barry 30 Watts. And sometimes I might be on 60, it depends on what sort of a day I was having. So that sort of stuck around me, my job for quite a while, this Watts business, 40 Watts. But otherwise, I was only known mainly as Wattsy. Whereas, which I didn't mention earlier, Dad was known as Mick Watts. Nobody knew him as Fred Watts. He was only known as Mick Watts. It was a real sticker, that one. Same with Bonza. Nobody knew his other name. Even people that he worked for, his bosses didn't know his name was Arthur. Then Leo and Jimmy Callahan, the drummer that took over after Glenn left, they went up to Queensland, so they'd get band folded up. We broke up there for a while, and later on I started playing with a band called Moonshine, which was a bit more modern stuff. We're doing Australian crawl and all that sort of stuff then. And we played for about 3 years up around doing the same sort of work, really, in the clubs and stuff. And then I left and went up to Rockhampton. When I was up there, then I played with about four or five different bands up there, freelanced around, and it was... we had some great times there, met some good people and learned a lot of stuff. Came home from Rockhampton and went back with Leo and Ross Lane, the three of us. Ross Lane played the drums, Leo on the keyboards, and this time we're called Blend. And we played for another about 4 years. We done some big Deb Balls and Chuka and Ballarat. We had a great time. Going back to the steel guitar, because of the rock and roll, all that went by the wayside. But later on, I was back in the 80s. I started getting interested back in playing the steel. I'd seen these pedal steel guitars on TV and said, oh, I'd love to have a crack at one of those things. So I eventually joined the SGA, which is Steel Guitar Australia. A fella in Tamworth had this going. I used to hear it on the radio. So I joined, and eventually bought a pedal steel guitar and started playing it. And I used to go to country music clubs then, so I had somewhere to sort of play this thing. Even though I was playing with a band called Moonshine at the time, I used to go to Cahoona Country Music Club, and I finished up playing the backing band and playing steel guitar. Later on, I traded that one. I sold that one and brought a double neck one off George Xanthos, who played steel guitar for Hawken Brothers. And I had that for quite... Well, I still got that today. And it was only a couple of years ago that I updated to one of the modern, more lighter and more versatile type of pedal steel. And I still play today in the country music clubs. I really enjoy playing that thing. It's probably never learned to play it properly. They're very technically hard to play, but anyway, I have a lot of fun with it. And it's right behind me, the new one there, just there. Started playing with Roadhouse, which Leo was in again, at the Sinana, the country music club, and we were the resident band, and we did their festivals, and I did that for another couple of years. And then I gave that away and just played down at Bendigo at the Country Music Club there in the backing band, and that's where I've been at till I got crook. So that was the sort of the end of that era. Around about the time we were playing at the Roadhouse at the St Arnold Club, we did get mixed up with a group called Sing Australia, based in Canberra. We happened to be at the same place, and they liked what we did. We backed them up. So that led us into being their backing band for their special dues. We did quite a few of their special festivals. They flew us to Perth, flew us up to Queensland, up to Malulumbar, and where we done a big show there. We went to Canberra. They flew us to Tassie, done a big show there, and we went to Parliament House a couple of times. We done played in the Great Hall there, and that was a magnificent experience for a lot of people. The fun nights. And it was just something that we sort of live in the dream, really. We just couldn't get over what we were doing. So that was just something that topped my musical career off pretty well, I'd say, with that. It was, yeah. Right, at this stage, I think we might talk about the motorcycles that's a big part of the Watts family. From my early memories, there was a Douglas that Dad used to ride to the mill. For a start, it only had a carbide light on it. And then they later on cut a bit of a gap in the mudguard so they could fit a dynamo off a push bike on there. So that was the later thing. So he just had a generator running on the wheel like you would a push bike. And he used that when he used to have to go to the mill, when he was on night shift and stuff. There was a matchless that Noe apparently had brought mainly for Archie to ride around. Noe wasn't into motorbikes that much. Noe was James, which is the nicknames we've got. I'll just go through them for a minute. Archie or John was called, the nickname was Archie, and his real name was John. Noe's real name was James, and he was called Noe, and Bonza's real name was Arthur, but he was called Bonza. Dorothy's name was Dorothy, but we called her Doss. And Fred was known as Fuzzy, but mainly just family. It wasn't well known that way. So we'll call Fred, but the rest will be called Noe and Archie and Bonza.
What about yourself?
And of course, I've sort of just Watsy. I never really had a... Sometimes I was called Pedro, but that was about it. It was mainly just Watsy. So anyway, I'll get back to the motorcycles. Noe had brought this matchless for Archie to ride to work on. Well, of course, when I went in the army, there was this motorbike sitting there that wasn't doing much, but Bonza was getting to the age around, 16, I suppose, or 14 or whatever. Whatever. And so he and some of his mates used to get on it and ride it around out in the bush and everything. And then Dad wanted to cut wood, and he had no ways of doing it till he thought about putting a belt on the... take the back tyre off and put a belt on the wheel and jack it up and run it, and he made up this saw bench out of bits of old wood and stuff, and the motor. Barrett Bonza would hop on it, and he'd just watch Dad when he put a big log on the bloody saw. He'd turn the throttle on and give it a bit more guts, and that was his job. And they cut wood quite often through the war years that way. So that was a bit of a novelty thing that happened with that motorcycle. When Archie came home from the war and got a job, he wasn't long before he brought a brand new Valisette 350 Mac, rigid frame, And they rode that around for a couple of years. Bonds had done most of the riding, but Jack was quite happy to sit on the back, and they used to go to the races and ride around all over the place. And then he sold that and brought a ES2 Norton 500 with a bit more power, and had a sprung heel and telescopic forks. It was a much better bike. It was about 1951, it was around that model year. And Bonzi used to have to go down to meet the train. Barkey was working down in Melbourne or somewhere, and of a Friday night, Bonzi would be listening to the radio to get the train times, and when it was due in, say 9 o'clock or whatever, he'd hop on the bike and go to Bendigo and pick up Barkey and bring him home. And Sunday night would be the same. He'd be delivering him down to the railway station at Bendigo for him to go back to Melbourne. So that went on for a couple of years. Every week. Well, then, in the meantime, or just after that, that's right, Bonds had brought a Harley Davidson, old Army Harley with a sidecar on it. Well, I used to ride it around the block with a few of my mates there from Boodle, and that they'd come up after school, and then we'd ride it around the backyard here. And then, and I used to go out with Bonzer in at spotlight shooting. I'd hold the spotlight and we used to go out shooting foxes and that sort of thing. It was quite fun, the old Harley. Then Bonzer brought an aerial 500 Red Hunter. And I had a few rides on that, as I shouldn't have had, out the bush. It was great, really nice bike to ride. Eventually, that's when I got my own, got my Ariel's 650, and it went to what I get after that. I brought a Lilac. It's a 300 Japanese V-twin. I had that, but I had to get rid of that when we went up to Queensland to the sheds the second time. Because I was still paying for it, and I couldn't do the payment, so I chucked it in. I started getting into the cars. I brought a Morris 21. Had it for a little while till it blew up. Then I brought an Austin Atlantic, and I had that for a couple of years till it blew up. And I've just fixed it up temporarily and traded it in on a BSA Super Rocket. I done a trip to Rockhampton on that. It was a good bike, and I rode it to work on the railways for quite a few years. Eventually selling that to a guy that actually went up to Queensland shearing and actually run into Noel in a shearing shed many years later on. And he had this bike that he'd brought off me. It was a small world. They couldn't get over that. Then I brought a Morris Oxford when I got married, and towed a caravan around for a little while with that, and then we settled in at Bort. And I went to, then I traded, well, I didn't trade it in, I think she just wore out, and I brought a Hillman Minx. And used that. So I was playing in the band then with the Hillman, and then I got a Falcon, XP Falcon. Yes, we went up to, done a trip to Queensland, up to Rockhampton, to Cairns, with the family, with the trailer, camping in that. That was our first trip away. So a few cars later on, we had some Toyotas, finished up with a Trago and a Hilux, which I've still got today. And that's the car business. In the meantime, motorcycles, at one stage at Bort there, we had a lot of small bikes when Barry and Matthew and used to be riding around. We'd go out at an evening into summer nights and ride on the back roads. We had a lot of little Honda XLs and SRs, and I forget now, I think we might have had about half a dozen of them in the yard there at one stage, but we used to ride around. Barry had a little Bombardier at one stage. He's still riding bikes today. Matthew's still riding. I'm still riding. I've got a Guzzy at the moment that's behind me there, you can see. And That's it. We hope we can still go. While I think about the life in the bush, we used to go to a place called Green Hills. On the way out there, it was in the scrub country, and back before my time, there was mallee fowl. My dad used to talk about them and other people, and there was some old mounds out in the bush there. So I sort of developed a bit of, I'd like to have known a bit more about them. They sort of, they weren't about at this stage, but they'd been around in the early 40s, about the last pair were seen out around that way, and what they called the Galloway Dam. And when I was on the actually Lands Department, I worked around the Wedderburn area and was in mallee fowl country, and I had a bit renewed the spark in me to do something about. Nobody seemed to know how many were there or much about them, but I knew where there was mounds, and because we were on the Lands Department, we had access to a lot of spots there. So when I retired, I used to drive down from Bort to the Wedderburn Bush, and I did actually find a working pair that nobody knew about. And from then on, I was hooked on doing some surveying and taking video. I did set up cameras, and I was working with parks and had permission to do a certain amount of stuff. And set up cameras on the mounds, still for taking 24-hour shots, night time and day, infrared ones, and plus video, live video, and I know a lot about mallee fowl that nobody knows about, and we've got a lot of footage, really, really important footage of their lives. Well, it was in the 60s where I first met Sheila. She was a local girl, and I'd seen her grow up, but we sort of got together and gradually got a relationship going, and we got married out at Maryborough. We had our reception at a friend's place at Arnold, Barry Young husband and Rosemary. They'd done a great job, and we had all that was done at their home at Arnold, and I appreciated that. We lived in the caravan, and we stayed at home for a little while, and then I brought the caravan from, towed it around with the old Oxford, and because my job was up around Manangatang and Ultima and those sort of places. And Barry was born in Inglewood, but most of the time we reared him up. We were up in Ultima most of the time till we came back to Bort, and eventually settled at Bort, and then we had Karen. And we moved out to Kerrang Road, to Avenant and Ab Sinclair and Elsie Sinclair's. And we rented a house out there for quite a few years out there, and that's when Tracy was born out there. So that was our family. Eventually we moved to Yole Street when I went on the Water Commission. We bought our own house in Yole Street, and that was... We were there for about 20 years, and that was home. That's where it all happened. We had a lot of fun there. That's when I eventually got a high-ace van, and we decided to do a trip to Darwin when Barry probably would be in about 12 or something like that. And I made a big roof rack that went from one end to the other, and spotlights, and we had a camp up in the top of it. That's when we got up in crocodile country. Other times, me and Barry just slept out on the ground, and the girls were in the van. Modified it a bit and had beds in there and cupboards and stuff. So we went to Darwin. on Corrugated Road. We went to Ayers Rock, and at that particular time you could drive to Ayers Rock and camp in the right at the base there in the, where the Aboriginal community were. And that's the Lindy Chamberlain episode you've probably heard about. Happened about a few days before we got there. But anyway, we made it to Darwin, and then we came back to the Darley Waters, and then went right across to Rockhampton, and then home from there. It was a big trip in the old van. I don't know how it made it, but we'd actually got home. I know one of the hills there, coming back from West Wylong across to Hay, I didn't think we were going to get over it. She was just about stonkered. But anyway, we managed to get over that hill, and it was downhill from there. We got it home. But in the meantime, it was we had some great experiences on that trip. We weren't on our own. Ab and Elsie Sinclair had a Mazda van, and there was two lots of us. So between us, it was okay. We had a great time. Of course, when we were at Yole Street, Karen was mad on horses. So a little bit of Dad's rubbed off on her. She was crazy about horses, and so we got her this horse she called Camel. And it would not stay in. I don't know how many times I had to let go. I'd be rang up at work to go and catch a horse and take. But anyway, eventually she grew out of the, we had to get rid of it. We just could not keep it. And we had a few episodes with other horses that come into the scene there, and there was a bit of fun and games. Tracy nearly got bucked off, and yeah. But anyways, it was just an episode. They had a lot of fun, but it was a bit of worry. Your Camel was caused a bit of strife. And of course, I used to go, I liked me fishing. So we used to go up to Kundrook a fair bit and camp up on the river up there. And I had a little wooden V-hull boat, very dangerous, really, even with about a four-horse Johnson on the back. And I caught my first cod there, actually. Then one time we were camped up there, and there was a flood on, and there was whirlpools, and there was all sorts of things, and I had a flat tyre and a Falcon, so I decided to take it into Kundrook by boat and get it mended and take it back again. And it was probably something, the most dangerous thing ever done, the two of us in this boat, and there was other people going round and round in whirlpools, and I didn't know whatever was going to happen. The boat was going in all directions. You couldn't hardly steer it. It was just that currents were taking us everywhere. But we managed to get to Kundrook, got the tyre mended, and then we were hours getting back because you just make headway against the current, and that's all. It was on one of these trips that my father actually died, and it was Barry's birthday at the time. We were up at the river. So that was a bit of a sad one, but we had to come home that night. When we came back from Queensland, we decided to sell Yole Street, sell out at Yole Street, because the kids were all, Barry was married, everybody was married except Tracy, when she was working away. So we decided to sell there so I could come down. Well, actually, I wanted to come to Inglewood, but I know he had the house here, and I sort of couldn't do anything till he was actually finished with the house here. So I thought, I looked around and found a place at Wedderburn, which is not that far away, and I thought, we'll try that. I brought a relocatable house, thinking, I can shift it down to Inglewood if necessary. So I bought this block of land at Wedderburn and I put a relocatable house on it. Now I'm right in the Mallyfowl country. I got mounts to the back of me and mounts to the right of me, and I'm in heaven. I'm out in the bush every day. So anyway, we built that up and improved on that bit of land. Had 140 acres there. And we were quite happy living there, really. The time came then when when Jim had had enough of the house, it was getting too much for him, so he went up to the hostel. And so then we could finalise the place, then it had to be sold, and so I brought the old place off the family and eventually put a new house on the second block, and that's where we are at the present time, and everything's pretty good. We've got a nice new house. When I was on the railways, scrap was worth a few extra dollars. So we used to always sort of manage to find the local tips, and we had a little bit of time on the job I was on. You know, you might have a few hours, you'd just sneak away and go to the tip and look and see how much copper wire and stuff we could find. And it all sort of started from there. And then there used to be some fellas, scrap buyers in the towns, had one, they used to come there regularly in different places. So we'd stockpile our copper wire and stuff and make a few dollars and buy a few beers with this stuff. And I can remember one of the issues was we found some wire hanging out of a building up the main street of Witcherproof. And Mitchell, a bloke that I worked with, Mick grabbed the wire and just wrapped it around himself and kept walking and pulled about 100 yards of wire out of a house up the street and rolled it all up. I don't know what... So, and we found old bowsers, you know, the brass cylinders in pump-up bowsers and stuff like that. We made quite a few dollars out of it. Well, then it didn't end there. When I got working on the Lands Department, we were on the same thing. We used to find all these scrap yards out in farms and go through, and anything that was worth a bit of dollars, we'd load up the old Land Rover, and we had a big stockpile at the back of the Lands Department yard at the board. And every Christmas we'd stash her in and go down the pub and get rotten. So much so that I ran off the road and smashed it bloody in the old Oxford and hit a post going around the corner. I had bloody drunk going home from work there one day after our celebrations. I'd be taking stuff up the tip and then I'd be always looking for something that's handy and bring more back than I want to take up the tip. So it was hard to deal with. You just couldn't go up the tip without bringing something home eventually. I'm always on the lookout, and a lot of good stuff would come back as well. So, and then, anyway, that was one of the things. And the other two jobs that I had, one was with a eucalyptus factory. McFarlane's had an open eucalyptus factory, and I used to work there for a while, and probably the best job I ever had. I loved that. Just stoking the old boiler up and getting rid of the leaves, and worked there for a while. It wasn't a lot of money in it, but it was a fill-in job. And then I started working with Henry Walker, and as I said earlier, the Walkers sort of are married into the family on my brother's side. And Henry was used to cut poles for the PMG and the SEC, mostly for the PMG, and all the telephone poles up around Bort, all that area, mostly all came from Henry Walker out at Maligal and Riola, all that area there. And my job was to snig the poles through with a horse. I'm back on the horses again, snigging poles through the bush and into a heap, and then loading them onto a truck, pull them up with a horse again, wrap a rope around from the truck back around the log, and then pull them up on that way, load them onto a truck. So that was my job for a couple of years. I'd done that on most for old Henry. And I often not bring up Henry's name because he used to sit very low in a big old Chev. You could just see over the bonnet and had no idea what was behind him. So he used to just go back slowly till he hit something and then go forward again. So that was the Henry Walker trick. And you just drive back till you hit something, you know you're going far enough. And he always had a butt, a cigarette in his mouth. All the time he had a little butt about an inch long that just stayed there, glued to his lip. And yeah, great old fella, Henry. And and that was great, working out in the bush again, you know. And the only downside was the bull ants. It was very, they'd be biting you on the ankles all the time there, and hell, I'd be going through all this misery with these bull ants, and Henry used to be laughing till one day they got up his pants and bit him on the knackers. And he pulled his pants down, and I had the last laugh that day. But, yeah, they were very savage out there. And that was just another little job I had, a fill-in job. It was a really good one. The highlight of having the Montaguzzi bike beside me here is that we done a trip to Tasmania a couple of years ago now, so 3 years ago, which is a bit of an ordeal for me, I suppose, because I only had the bike a short time. I wasn't really used to it. And we went to Tassie and done the tour of Tasmania on the bike. I didn't know whether I was going to make it home that night each time. I'd have to say my prayers to think I was going to get through the next day. But it was a great trip. I got to thank my son Barry and his friends for, you know, asking me to go on that trip with them. I was a bit of a worry to them too. They were worried about me more than I was. But I was worried about them too, because I used to fly a bit. But it was something that I'm glad I done. Now, the aerial motorcycle was something that I'd have to tell a bit more about. I joined the Bendigo Motorcycle Club, and we used to go out to Ravenswood. They had their own scramble track out there, and I found it nice to race around with the local fellas when they were training on the aerial, which wasn't really set up for scramble work, but I found I could keep up with them. I had a bit of extra power, so I got a competition licence and thought, well, I might have a go at this business. So I entered in a Williamstown scramble, which they used to have at the old range down at Williamstown, and went down there and raced. I didn't win. I had mechanical trouble, but I was holding my own there for quite a while till I had that trouble. It was a bit of an interesting thing to do. I thought, well, I might have a go at road racing. Down at Colder, it opened up. So I hotted her up a little bit more and altered it to road racing specifications and went down there to race there. But unfortunately, when I was unloading out of the trailer, I got my finger caught in the back sprocket and tore the top of my finger off, and I couldn't race it that day. So that didn't eventuate, but it was fairly exciting to get to that part of it anyway. But later on, when we were living up at Bort, and I was married, I still used to take it out and have a go at some local events up at Bort. And one of the events was a drag race on the Kerrang Road. And I raced against a Norton Commando on it, which was new out at the time. And he did beat me, but not by much. And I raced that on a scramble around the Bort Lake, the same. But it was a bit much for it. It was a bit heavy. They had pretty sharp bumps there. They were sort of set up for lighter bikes. But anyway, it was a bit of fun on the old aerial. I'd done those sort of things on it. And I've kept that bike since then. And it's at the moment, we've got it up at Bort, and we're restoring it back to the original condition pretty well. Most of me mates and that, all sold their motorcycles, but I kept mine, and it's been really good to still have that bike. Well, I hope you've enjoyed my story. If I missed your name, I'm sorry. That there'll be some follow-ups, and we'll sort that out later on. But at the moment, we're sort of working on a schedule here. We haven't got a lot of time to put everything in, so I'm sorry if I've missed anybody. And I hope you've enjoyed what I've had to say so far.
county jail. The prison band was there and they began to wail. The band was jumping and the drum began to swing. You should have heard the locked out jailbird sing. Let it rock. Everybody let it rock. Everybody in a home say a block. Put dance to the jail out rock. Spider Murphy played his inner saxophone. Little Joe was blowing on the slide trombone. The drummer for the Eleanor would crash boom bang. The whole rhythm section was a purple gang. Let it rock. Everybody let it rock.
Rock, 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 rock